almost a decade ago.
It's, God, I keep forgetting that that's in the mix.
Yeah.
Because it's like, I always dig your curious picks, and mm-hmm. and I know you put effort and energy into picking good stuff. So I was like, oh, let's talk about your curation abilities. You're like, no curation, sucker. I made this
well,
one.
Well, so I woke up with a passion on Saturday, and I ended up writing most of a new song, which is not this, but it's making me think a lot about what my next album will be.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. So I'm going back and listening to some older stuff and
can I tell you, like, that's a terrifying journey to make, because, you know, nostalgia is a double-edged sword, because yeah. it's like, on the one hand, it reminds you of what you're capable of, but on the other hand, it reminds you that maybe your best times are behind you.
Yeah. And thankfully, the result of that process was, oh, I do make some good music.
Do you think Japanese sword makers get upset when you say double-edged sword, and they're like, ours are perfectly good?
I do. Hey, let me grab this. Could you reach over, grab the studio monitor, and point it over towards?
Yeah. Put it on the
just kind of set it on that little bezel right there on the front. I don't think I used the word bezel correctly. No, base. The base. There we go. Base.
Oh, hey, my mom just liked the tweet where I said the thing that I just said a minute ago.
Right on.
Yeah. I get nice little pleasant surprises. Where my mom will just favorite tweets.
My mom says, I want you to know, every time you ever tweet anything, I open it up and I hit play and I turn off the volume so that you get the complete credit for whatever it is you're doing.
Before I moved out, and it might still be true, I know that my mom had an alert on her phone that would ping her every time I tweeted.
Oh, yeah.
Or so she would always, it would just, like, deliver it to her phone or whatever, which is very nice, but also, like, I tweet some stupid shit.
Well, I mean, but also, like, you're in that, in the wastelands period where it's like, you want to get as far away from the nest as possible right now. It's sure. like, once you get past 30, it's like, it's kind of adorable that mom is still following.
I sometimes can't even call up my parents, my mom, to tell her, like Publishers Weekly may have just announced, you know, a new book deal that I have coming, right? And I'll be like, hey, call her up, and I'll get listen to 10 minutes of her talking about her day. And then I'm like, oh, I'm here, I gotta go. Like,
big day.
The lack of interest she has in anything I've done.
Well, in her mind, you're like, well, it was a big day. We got 4 hummingbirds. And Andrew sold a book deal.
No, we never get to the book deal. Never even get to the, I mean, yeah! I've had conversations where I've called with news, and I get the trip to Costco. I get the epic journey finding the phone. You know, how she found the phone, where the phone was. It's like Lord of the Rings every time they try to find the phone rings. And so I have times like I'm just like, oh, because you're like, you got to call some news. You got to call. Like, hey, I got to call. And then you're like. And then, like, I had 10 minutes to make this call between here and my next stop, and I didn't get to tell them the news.
All right, guys. Well, I think I'm ready to go, if y'all are.
So I love to hear about other people who have parents that care.
Welcome to Parenting Hour.
Parent things.
My dad likes to hear
really?
This stuff.
I have a buddy from college who would never be on the phone with his parents for longer than 90 seconds. Yeah. Every conversation would always
Did he
wrap
actually
up.
Start the timer?
I think
he was like
think
the time hacker
some...
from Mr. Robot. go,
I think he had done it so much that it was just like, and they talk a lot. They call each other a lot. So I think
right.
it's not like a huge deluge every time, but it was scary. Like, how often?
No, it must have been like interval training. It was just like you actually got a better workout if you only did it for 2 minutes at a time.
HIIT, yeah.
Right.
All right. I'm feeling it.
All right.
Super excited.
Well, let me go here. All right. Take it away, Andrew. In 3, 2.
Wait. Hold on. Send you a link. Stop
wow.
everything.
That was close. Ooh. That was close.
Oh, man.
Stop we almost had a false launch, people.
Thing.
Almost pulled a SpaceX. Everybody calm down. Look, look for snipers.
I pulled the pip and everything, man.
Maybe aren't.
Hold on. Okay. I just wanted to send you a link before we started.
Okay. Is this a private link?
I'm good. Why aren't we starting?
Oh, my gosh. I don't know if this is a private link. Okay. Then let's do this. Take it away, Andrew, in 3, 2.
Welcome to the Weird Things Podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Brian Brushwood.
Oh, heck yeah. Sitting here in America, where all the hosts should always be.
Yeah, I mean, I couldn't imagine what it would be like in some other country, but maybe Justin can tell us about that. Justin Robert Young?
Well, greetings from Edinburgh, Scotland.
Oh, dude, wait. I'd love to think like you're undercover looking for Nessie. Like you're on location. Since you're audio only, you can just tell us all the lies that'll make us super excited.
We're here by the lapping shores of Loch Ness, where I have found with 100% certainty a bottle of empty Jameson.
See, gentlemen, enjoy your merriment while you can, because November is fast approaching, and November 22nd, 1963 was known for one particular tragedy when we lost President John F. Kennedy to the assassin Lee Harvey Oswald. But there was a much lesser known tragedy. It's one of those things when you hear about things that happened on one day and everybody talks about this tragedy and the other thing doesn't get as much as attention.
It was the same day as the Kennedy assassination?
This thing I'm about to tell you about, yeah.
And, so we're not supposed to guess. I thought we were playing that game.
You can guess.
Oh, yeah? Okay, all right, Justin, what kind of tragedy, not as big as the Kennedy assassination, happened the same day?
Oh, man. The debut of the Egg McMuffin.
More people died. And, man, he's in Europe, and he's already putting down American food.
he's become one of them.
Oh, they got it out here too. It's
Joy or Haggis.
It's McDonald's.
No. Okay, so 11/22/63.
It was a tragedy. Lives were lost. Four lives were lost.
Four lives were lost.
More lives were lost. There's an air of mystery still around it, not quite solved.
Oh dear. Can we get a geographic? Is this an East Coast phenomenon or a West Coast phenomenon?
This was an East Coast phenomenon.
East Coast thing. No, I was about to. I immediately thought of that Boston Molasses Massacre, which, by the way, we need to.
I love the Boston Molasses Massacre.
I was hoping, but it's not. That is the weirdest.
Is it? I don't know.
No,
maybe.
No, no, it's not, because that was like 80 or 90 years ago.
Well, there was finally a memorial has been erected for this, and. And it's one of these things. It's just a tragic mystery, just sort of lost down history's time hole. And I'm talking about the Staten Island Ferry disaster.
What happened during the Staten Island Ferry? I assume there's a disaster with a ferry.
It's close to 4 a.m. on the quiet morning, November 22nd, when the steam ferry Cornelius J. Kolff vanished without a trace, on its way with nearly 400 people, mostly on their way to work. The disappearance of the Cornelius G. Kolff remains both one of New York's most horrific maritime tragedies and perhaps the most intriguing mystery ever. Eyewitness accounts describe large tentacles which pulled the ferry beneath the surface only a short distance from the Whitehall Terminal in Lower Manhattan.
Okay, this is my excitement of mourning that you're seeing right now. I'm mourning the loss of lives as I appear to giddily... want to ask about the tentacles. All right, first of all, this is a documented thing. Like, real people definitely died.
Brian, there's a website and a memorial and a 3.5-minute documentary. What more evidence do you need?
Wait, there's a museum?
Wait a minute. Wait, so eyewitness account said that there was a tentacle that pulled this ferry down below the waves, killing all those aboard?
Yeah.
Okay.
We've got a visual.
Oh, we do?
We have a potential visual of what it might have looked like.
Oh, this is...
on the ferry.
Oh, my. Hold on. Okay. Time up. I'm assuming this is the memorial. What you're seeing is... It's
okay. By the way, I'm not getting video. So
okay, great, Justin. All right. So, first of all, I want you to picture a pedestal that is finely made. Looks like granite with brass on it that says dedicated in loving memory to the passengers and crew of the Cornelius G. Clough, who lost their lives on November 22nd, 1963 in one of the most mysterious and tragic maritime disasters in American history, erected by the Staten Island Ferry Memorial Foundation and Chemical Bank. Thank you, Chemical Bank. So real quick, what do you suppose a fitting memorial to this true tragedy about the loss of 400 lives?
I mean, let's go ahead and skip the horseplay because I just got this link in the Skype chat. Oh my God, this is just 20,000 leagues under the sea, like the Kraken arising. This is a monstrous creature that has to be the size of the boat itself, if not larger, ripping it down below the waves.
It really does. It looks like, I guess on top of that, it says, Staten Island Ferry, and it's pulling it down like with a vengeance. It's that cold-hearted terror, like, no, you belong down here with me as a plaything.
Because, like, you would... In my head, let's assume, although as far fetched as a tentacled creature ripping a ferry down below the waves in the shores, you know, between or in the waters between Manhattan and Staten Island, in general would be, if it were to have it, I guess like I would think that maybe it was some kind of, you know, an accidental thing maybe, but like this is like as if there's some sort of magical talisman on the ferry, and it needs to be returned to the sunken treasure for which it was stolen.
Yeah. Okay. So let's put this in perspective. Let's say that the theory that a giant tentacle monster pulled down the Staten Island ferry was 100% confirmed and well known, and it was as well documented as like 9/11, which apparently is still not well documented enough. Yeah. But
great context there, Brian.
But. It would be the equivalent of making a memorial to the assassination of JFK that, like, showed Lee Harvey Oswald in bronze, like, aiming and the exploding head of the president at the same time. Like, that is a tacky, tasteless memorial if it's totally true.
Well, I direct your attention to the total proof. Go to the News and Articles and Artifacts page on the website, Bryce, if you can. And news articles is great. Now, some people might point out the fact that other than the fact that a Google Internet search will turn up absolutely no evidence of this at all. Not all the records that we had about newspapers are there. Some people might point out that these, quote, cuttings from the newspaper are not full justified and use non-standardization for doing
it
hyphenation.
Really does. It really
some
does.
Might say that they look manufactured. In fact, the entire event looks like it could have been faked. But I pose this. Suppose you were the maritime ferry industry and you were dependent upon the livelihood of your industry succeeding. Maybe it would be in your interest to put out fake-looking newspaper articles and perhaps even to convince the families of the victims it never happened anyways.
Okay. All right. You got it.
Oh, a cover-up.
You gotta peel back the onion on this, because this looks. First of all, is the memorial at least a real thing? Is that an actual statue somewhere?
I believe so. This is a photo. We're seeing a photo.
It looks like a genuine photo of a Kraken.
I believe there actually is a physical memorial that was installed.
Was. Wow. Okay. So who? Where is the money for this coming from? Is there another
chemical bank? You can buy some t-shirts online at the website if you want, depicting the horrific accident.
Here, what is this this website?
It's a sioctopusdisaster.com.
The SI, I'm sure, stands for Skeptical Inquiry of the Staten Island Octopusmonster.com.
Oh my God, these t-shirts are not any more tasteful.
No, you're witness, like assuming they believe this is real. They are t-shirts of a mass murder.
This looks like a bronze sculpture of the actual memorial that we just described for $100 US.
So some people, and perhaps a guy by the name of Joe Reginella, who is an artist, and built a monument to this this disaster that never happened and
Hold
put it on.
On
display.
Hold on. Are you saying what I think you're saying? Are you saying this is all an art project?
Yes.
Oh, this is the best thing ever! Oh my god! Oh, this is wonderful!
So apparently, I don't believe anything, but Joe Reginella apparently actually made the bronze sculpture and put it on display, like in Staten Island or somewhere there. And people walked by, and there's this memorial to this horrific tragedy where an octopus killed 400 people.
Do you think Chemical Bank had anything to do with it?
The New York Post: artist fools tourists with monument to giant octopus attack on Staten Island ferry.
Oh man, that's some Banksy level stuff, dude. That's great.
Yeah.
Hey, by the way, I'm just no one mind me. I'm buying this T-shirt.
Actually,
there's about a 3.5 minute documentary which they do it, which I highly recommend it. It's worth just alone to hear the expression. It was a effin' octopus. I just want to point out the glee at which you was obvious in your eyes at the thought that this could actually be real, and now, you know, the thought that this may not have been, you know, an actual thing.
Well, it's even more gleeful because it removes any ask, like,
guilt.
Like now, well, and now all of a sudden, like, I'm on team. Let's push this hoax out. What's the website again? SI Octopus.
It's SIOctopusDisaster.com.
I'm buying that T-shirt. I'm gonna wear it on Scam Squad. I'm gonna wear it on the Modern Rogue.
Never forget. Never forget.
Well, and that's part of, like, all of a sudden now, once you know it's an intentional art piece, you know that the selection of the date, you know, is intentional, and like, oh, that's why you never heard about it.
Well, no, so yeah, so I'm reading here through the website a little bit, and that's definitely part of it, is that, like, you know, kind of like unfortunately relegated to the dustbin of history because of when it happened. You know, there is this horrifying tragedy.
There's a page that just says artifacts. And there's two images of a shoreline with like bits of I don't know if this is a hull or what, ship pieces, and you can kind of see a part of the city in the background. But this one photo on the left, very clearly, this is just like one of the Apple iPhone.
This is just
filters.
An Instagram filter,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, this is just an iPhone filter.
That's amazing.
So it's just basically, yeah, it's two pictures. One of which is very clearly modern, right? And in modern color and saturation. And then the other one is just like an old-timey filter from Instagram, like when you would see somebody's brunch in. It is just – and like, why would they put the same photo next to each other?
Dude, I want this guy, whoever he is, to just get a massive rush of T-shirt orders and just have him be super confused as to why this is happening. That's amazing.
On the webpage they have visit, they actually list the prices to go to the museum. College students are free, by the way. Getting here, mass transit. Take subway to Lower Manhattan via the 1 train to South Ferry, or the 4-5 train to Bowling Green, or the R train to Whitehall. Exit and walk south to Blue Neon Staten Island Terminal to take free ferry. After landing in Staten Island, take the S40 bus at Gate D to travel along Richmond Terrace, less than a 10-minute ride. Let the bus driver know that you want to get off at Snug Harbor.
Are these real things?
I think at some point you're going to find out that it's not. I just love the commitment like that. I think that might be, if we do a New York trip, is we try to find the Staten Island Ferry Disaster Memorial Museum.
Oh, that would be great.
By the way, we
actually have somebody that we could send on this adventure. Sitting here in studio right now is Curtis LaRocque, who lives in Manhattan. Is that right? Mm-hmm. You can follow these exact directions.
I can.
All right, right on.
We'll hold you to that. I'm expecting an email.
Maybe that could be a Weird Things project where we actually take photos of exhibits in the museum. Like posing, like us, like, and we find other maritime stuff or things like that. Like the maritime history section here is amazing.
Oh, we could hoax our visit to the non-existent museum. Yeah. That would be fun.
Yeah.
As long as we use the same Instagram filter.
Well, again, that was a photo taken in 1963, guys. All right? Jeez.
And recreated last week.
Yeah. Yeah. So, listen, don't believe anything. I don't believe anything ever at all. Nothing's real at all. Everything is fake.
Yeah, it's amazing also how all these news articles are all written in the same font. Oh. Including the ones from 1963, 1979, and 1973 with page numbers on them.
When they're faded in the exact same way, too. They're
well,
the same
they're
shade
not
of
justified. Yellow. That they're all
yeah,
you know,
because they do columns justified. Of text normally, but instead this was clearly just written in Microsoft
There's like
Word.
A hyphenate. There are two hyphenated words on these articles. I don't even think they did that back then.
Yeah, only for super big words yeah. would you break that down. So it's funny just to see how. That was like when the fake Bush letter came out claiming, you know, for the deferment
oh,
or whatever,
yeah.
Yeah, you know, and it was like, clearly there were problems. It just like, clearly it was a forgery, but it was like, ah, it's still going to be true.
That's
a
amazing.
Certain CBS journalist. Gentlemen, you know, while Justin is in the little
the misty moors of Scotland,
yeah, and around there, are your travels to the UK going to take you to Somerset by chance?
I am not familiar with the geography of this fine island, but I'm assuming if it would really only be on the train ride back to London tomorrow.
I think it might be south. Let's go take a look. I know, and this is really hilarious to people who know. Yeah, it's in very much the south of the island. So
no is how yeah. I would describe that one as a no.
Yeah, our British lens. Somerset's basically, I think, where like King's Landing is. So, you know, just so point of reference.
Hold on. You mean where the exterior shots of King's Landing are shot? Or
no,
do you
there's
mean,
an
no,
the actual place called King's Landing.
Wait, actual
for
reals? King's Landing, right?
Oh. Yeah.
Are there actual dragons? Is there an actual wall in the north?
I haven't been dragons for like hundreds of years, Brian.
Oh,
all right.
Got it. I'm sorry. I got a little silly there for a
yeah,
moment.
Yeah, don't be an a-hole, Brian.
Fair enough. Jesus. Fair enough.
So anyhow, the reason I bring this up is that they had, according to the Western Morning News, which, I mean, listen, this could be a prank newspaper, like, because I'm at this point where I believe nothing at all.
I mean, after the great Staten Island ferry betrayal, I mean, believe nothing, I say.
Yeah. So, anyhow, this is an item from there, which was apparently they decided to post. This is from last year, October 30th. They got a bunch of the 999 calls. By the way, Justin, if you get in trouble there, call 999, not 911, okay?
Yeah, no, we actually found that out through a friend of ours last night, and we're just delighted by the fact that Herman Cain was so popular out here that they renamed their emergency system.
There is a car ran into a tree across the street from me, which that tree is like had like three cars get cars run into it because people decide to take that corner way too fast. And one of the women who lives in the apartment upstairs, she's like, yeah, I called 911. Then I remember we're not supposed to call 911. I go, wait, what do you mean? She goes, oh, well, in Burbank, you know, we're supposed to call some other number. I'm like, because they say they'll get there faster. I'm like, what effed up system do we have here where the local Burbank authorities tell you, no, don't call 911. Call this other number because if you want the police to respond, it's like your tax dollars at work. Anyhow, so they've got hold of a bunch of calls that had gone into the 999 number to see what were some of the things that people had been calling. For instance, somebody called to report that there was a werewolf in her bath.
Okay.
Somebody else said that they had a goblin at his front door. So
turns
apparently somebody
both,
did.
Both of them are Ashley talking about Justin.
Yes. So apparently they did. Somebody did a freedom information request to pull this up, and they got a lot of strange calls. Yeah. One caller told Avon and Somerset police there was a werewolf in her bath, while another said he or she had become a ghost. A man from Weston-super-Mare, Somerset, reported a goblin at his front door. Another claimed there was a ghost holding a gun. There was also a ghost coming out of the TV. And in 2013, the force received a call from a man who was adamant there was a ghost in his house because it had gone cold.
Oh, doggone it. Like, so many of these, I feel like, okay, these are cries for help for people having medical emergencies.
There was also reports of ghostly cats and one who believed she was expecting. Brian, this will totally debunk your theory right now, okay?
All right.
A ghost baby.
like expecting for dinner?
No, actually, that supports your theory of mental illness. Sorry, totally wrong.
Yeah, well, I mean, but some of them, like the people who says, I'm afraid I'm turning into a ghost, like, you know, there's weird things like alien hand syndrome or whatever, you know, maybe somebody's having. But the other stuff where it's like people are just dumb, like there's ghosts because it's cold. I mean, that's not dumb. That's super smart. That's a good way to look for ghosts.
So it's interesting they have like other ones. Someone reported a witch outside a house in Bristol stirring her cauldron. I'm like, did she carry the cauldron there? It was a fire.
On the back of a flatbed pickup truck.
A woman in Somerset claims she had died and become a zombie. Now, of course, we're all saying like harassment, mental illness, all this, but perhaps you're being a little bit too harsh there, Brian. Simon Bamflied. I mean, again, I love the names over there. They're like, it's like Harry Potter land, really. From the Bristol Ghost Club said, I can understand why the police find it difficult to respond. It can be really difficult because sometimes it's psychological issues, but sometimes it could be true. He says, I've been investigating for about 10 years, and I must say about what percent, all right, numbers game, what percent does he claim to be genuine cases?
Oh, of the supernatural?
Yeah.
This is a cop who investigates these calls.
No, this is a guy from the Bristol Ghost Club. I mean, he may be a police officer.
Oh,
but I
got
do not
it. The guy from the Ghost Club, that fundamentally changes things. I'm going to say 90%.
Oh, no, no, no. Come on, Brian. Like, be reasonable. 50-50, I think.
So we have a call of 50. We have a call of 90. And the answer is, survey says, he says 70% are genuine, right down the middle.
Splitting the diff.
Justin wins by Price is Right rules, though.
Yeah. So, and he says the rest might be figments of somebody's imagination. I think you're right. I think that I'm not into, like, a lot of times you'll see things on Facebook, like, police pull over this crazy person with spray paint on their face and a bag of meth. And you're like, let's look at this idiot. And it's like, yeah, let's look at this person who's probably bipolar and has mental health issues. You know, a lot of these things really are genuinely crazy people. And it makes us feel better to laugh, but it's not all that different than, you know, 200 years ago when we'd make fun of the mentally handicapped. We just don't always recognize that that's actually what it is.
Well, and by the way, the whole like recognition of mental illness is a phenomenon like maybe 40 or 50 years old as far as like decent Western medical science. I mean, the whole idea of double-blind medical science is just over 100 years old. So it's like the idea of mental illness diagnoses and so on. Before that, it was all devils, demons, crazy people. I don't know what they called them back then.
Tetched. I mean, they had, I mean, they knew.
Whatever it is, you should call 999 for it.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, there's been, I mean, going back a couple thousand years in modern contemporarily, I mean, from the point of view, like people like in ancient Greece and all that, they understood, you know, there was concepts of mental illness. There was all sorts of wide degree of explanations for it, but they also could see that there were these physical causes. You know, somebody got hit in the head, you know, by blunt instrument, whatever. They weren't the same. Right. Somebody had some sort of childhood illness.
But they would also make up diseases like hysteria, that's the woman's disease, and that kind of stuff.
Oh, that's real. Well, that's real.
Don't say that in front of my wife.
Why? Will she get
hysterical?
I'm going to watch myself now. seriously, folks, this seriously. You know, it's not easy trying to be on the front lines of all this weirdness out there. I know, actually, it's easy. We just sit here from the comfort of our homes, which we don't want to do. We want to go out and investigate. We want to do more. We want to bring this to you. We want to make Curtis, who's sitting in the studio right now, Brian, go out and find and track down to see if
Yeah.
There really is something more to the Staten Island
Ferry. You think
those
bus tokens are going to buy themselves? You think that subway card is just going to manufacture itself out of thin air? Look, if it does, we'd call 999 and let everybody know. But guess what? It ain't going to happen. So instead, we need you guys to head on over to patreon.com. That's patreon.com/weirdthings and join the Weird Legion.
Now,
do you think that you're going to get somebody to go down to Staten Island for free? No. Like, you're going to have to pay that person.
And, you know, our longer term plan, you know, we've talked a lot about Mars, going to Mars, exploring Mars, and our plans for sending Bryce to Mars. Yep. And, you know, that ain't easy.
That ain't going to happen for free. It's going to, we have to start saving now. We're going to create the piggy bank. We're going to call it Bryce's piggy bank. And we're hoping to build up to that $175,000 of expected expense to get him a seat to Mars.
Yeah. I feel comfortable saying if we get $175,000, I'll go to Mars.
Oh, geez. You heard it, ladies and gentlemen. Well. We now have, we're all on the same
I'm calling Elon Musk's bluff.
We even have a suggested URL for donations.
Oh, sure.
MarsNeedsBryce.pizza. Just head there. Hopefully that'll forward you over to the Patreon page where you can make that happen.
Listen, and we're willing to, if we come in a little bit short, see if we can't send them as flat pack cargo, whatever, we'll do that.
Sure,
we're
sure.
Dedicated.
They have to assemble me.
We're that dedicated, the spirit of exploration that we will send Bryce, carrying with our hopes
and dreams. You know what's going to end up happening? If we don't hit our numbers, we're going to have to like go beg somebody who's actually headed there and just say, look, just take this fingernail. You just tuck it in there, put it in your clothes somewhere. Just let us believe that part of Bryce
made it.
No,
Brian, I believe we are going to send Bryce to Mars.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, we will then need to raise more money for our memorial when that rocket is taken down by an octopus outside of Staten Island.
That's true.
So speaking of going to Mars and funding, hot on the heels of the SpaceX announcement, and I'm in the middle of writing my book on Mars called How to Make Money on Mars, A Guide to Martian Economics, talking about like what corporations would want to be involved and what would be the risks versus other sides of that. And I'm still like saying like, yeah, some corporations might be. And as I'm writing this, literally John Legere, head of the CEO of T-Mobile, says on Twitter, I'll give away a trip to Mars if this tweet gets 1 million retweets by October 11th. you know, the normally media shy, very, very cautious guy has offered.
Yeah,
to,
exactly.
So basically what they're doing is offering to pay the $200,000 for yet unannounced tickets for a yet unbuilt spacecraft to Mars. But he is already trying to jump in front of that Mars rocket and put the T-Mobile name there.
I mean, that seems like the best way to make that kind of giveaway promise is when you know for a fact there'll be nothing to give away on the timeline. Or that is number one.
For as long as you are going to be the CEO of T-Mobile.
Exactly, right?
Yeah, his website is – this is the guy who's head of a major telecom, and you need to click on the link and go look at his website.
By the way, looking at it now, it's clear like he's got a gradiated thing where it's like he probably will give away a free trip to somewhere in the U.S. for 10,000 retweets.
Yeah, they're already at 13,000 retweets.
Yeah, okay. And the second one is a chair.
zero gravity chair.
Yeah,
please.
No, I'm sure. Look, everything's zero gravity on your way to Mars.
Well, technically microgravity, Brian, but, you know, it's
sure.
I know. Those discussions drive me nuts. I'm like, well, where does zero gravity exist? Technically, you have to, like, go between galaxies.
Man, dude, if there's one more tedious thing, man, I hope some gun enthusiasts are listening right now because, man, oh, man, has the world gotten on my balls about my use of the word automatic to describe a handgun? It's semi-automatic, and it's like I'm pretty sure, you know, it's called a 9mm automatic for a reason. And it's like I look it all up, and it's like any gun that auto loads the next bullet is an automatic as opposed to a revolver. And in the category automatic, there are two types: there's full auto and semi-auto. And this was a semi-automatic handgun, but I called it an automatic handgun, and wow, does the world love to get pedantic about their guns.
I will defend that pedantry, if I may use
sure,
that
sure, sure,
word.
Yeah.
In that the problem is that a lot of the media, you're not media, you're a guy talking, just doing stuff. You're not a journalist, you know, telling people from the position of authority, this sort of stuff. There is a lot of misinformation in mainstream stuff about guns and things like that, and what's assault rifles and things like that. And that certainly frustrates a lot of people in the gun thing. And you got the blowback from that.
Well, and that's the funny part, is I understand their frustration. They are a group of people who they're very hobby. They can't even say the thing that they're into without people suddenly throwing judgment and prejudicial suspicions about why they're into it and all that stuff. And they're also, you know, it's like they constantly are watching misreports and all that stuff. I get all of that, but it's like, but
why do you
want
to take your guns, Brian?
I know, and I'm sympathetic to their position, and it's like my reward for being sympathetic is that all of them turn into walking stereotypes, where it's just like whatever you would imagine the dumbest gun-toting thug canned automatic response would be, that's all I'm getting.
Is this on YouTube
or our guns or where?
Yeah, this is just more like the comments still keep rolling in. The misinformed comments keep rolling in on the Modern Rogue video where we tested a semi-automatic non-lethal way to disperse pepper gas or pepper spray slash it's a combination of pepper spray and tear gas pellets in this gun. And I've never done this before. They finally broke me. I just started deleting comments. I'm just like, don't be a cartoon.
I had a back and forth on Reddit when I was explaining the problem with a proposed alternative to the Elon Musk ITS architecture. And I said something about like this alternative would take like four times the amount of fuel. And they're like, no, that won't work. It won't even won't get there at all. And I'm like, well, I mean, it would. He's like, no, that's not how orbits work. And I'm like, and this back and forth kind of thing. I'm like,
you guys are on the same team. You're saying,
oh yeah, we're on the same team. Yeah. And like, I mean, I get Tsiolkovsky, I can't pronounce his name, but I understand the point of his equations, Hohmann transfers and all that. And it was like, and I'm like, yeah, if you just left earlier in the window. And he goes, oh yeah, no, you're right. It's like, yeah, I know. If you left at the same time, but you had less energy, yeah, you would totally. It was one of these things. Like, no, trust me, we get it. We're on the same page. But it's that kind of like you're afraid you're entering into a low information discussion, which happens the more you get into space stuff and all that. Is you find yourself presented with a lot of low information discussions where people are like, well, why don't we do this? And why? I'm like, listen, between me and you, there's a thing called the internet that has a lot of answers. and you can find them, and then we can have discussions. But if you're just going to go, explain to me this, that, man, you could have asked that in fewer words on Google. So,
yeah.
Man, the problem is that you guys just keep wandering into these contentious arguments. You should be like me and spend your time in relaxing environs, like running a political podcast.
Is that just a daily thing? Because fortunately/unfortunately, like, I don't know, all of the guff we get on the Modern Rogue is in public, whereas, like, I'm assuming most of yours is in emails that come in, and you just, like, once you see it's four paragraphs plus, you just type, LOL, I like politics, too.
Yeah, it's funny. I really, things have been pretty clean, really, like, since I've done the show, but, and even with BitTorrent and everything, like, everything was pretty good, and then for whatever reason, I don't know what happened over these last 3 days. You know, people really got their Irish up about politics. Hmm. And, you know, it's you want to know what? It's not the four paragraphs. It's the four emails in quick succession that are all one sentence.
Ugh. Like, yeah, I lost it and went on a pout parade on Twitter last night. Just like, it's like, I'm just out of energy for the fact that, like, I'm like, oh, I would like a distraction on Twitter. And it's like, I just can't find anyone not either crowing about how happy or upset or fighting one way or the other. It's just
so,
like,
Justin, while you're in England, I have a mission for you.
Yeah.
Brian, we can keep going that way.
No. Keep going.
I know. I'm saving us.
Yeah, no, please.
I know. So while you're in England, we have a mission for you, okay? And it's on your way back to – you're going back to London, right?
I'm going back to London, yeah.
It's really close. It's really, really, really close. This is some next-level spy stuff.
Okay.
Are you down for this? This is important. It's critical.
Sure.
Brian, did he sound a little too cavalier?
Well, I mean, I don't think he really understands the gravity. This is an official Weird Things investigation mission you're being presented with. And I got to back my co-host here and say, like we feel like you need to understand the gravity of what you're agreeing to.
Well, I don't know. Wait, I mean, I'm agreeing to hear what you're going to say.
Stepping back already.
All right, no, that's fine. It's probably the sensible thing to do, given what the nature of this is.
So, Mr. Neil Armstrong, listen. Come into my office. I'm NASA supervisor. Come sit down. Whoa. Before I sit down and hear what proposal you have for me, Neil Armstrong, and this is like 1968, I need to know a little bit more. Right, is that your attitude?
All right, hold on. In Justin's defense, Neil Armstrong at least was asked, would you like to go to the moon? And then said yes.
Do we know when he was at? I mean, before he was asked, was he like, listen, before you ask me anything, guys.
Do you think he's like, you're going to go on a trip. It turns into a Weird thing scenario where it's like, would you like to go places?
And then, I'm saying, he gets called into some office, they've got to ask at some point, was he getting all cagey like Justin was before the ask even came through?
I don't think Justin was cagey. I think he's ready to hear the proposal.
I like to believe that Andrew's on the forefront of the moon proposal hoax. Like, not that the moon landing was a hoax, but rather that Neil Armstrong was hoodwinked into going.
Like, he didn't know until he was about to land. He was like, well, I thought it was just a free cruise. So
like, this simulator is really accurate, guys. Buzz Aldrin's, you know, snickering in the corner.
Yeah.
All right. Got him, boss.
We got him. He said he would never go to the moon.
So let's, like, guys, I said there's one place I'd never take a spaceship to.
You owe me $50.
So there was a discovery. There was the Wentworth Elm. Wentworth Elm was thought to have been long extinct. This beautiful, majestic elm tree, which was beloved by, hell if I know. Anyhow, they thought
somebody
loved it.
I mean, everybody loves some trees sometimes.
Yeah, the wee forest folk did. And apparently they thought it was all wiped out in Great Britain during the 1970s, chopped down a tree for old the Queen Day. That actually was Dutch elm disease epidemic, just wiped away, killed between 25 and 75 million elms across the UK. So they're like, man, we lost this elm. What do we do with this elm? And it's gone and whatnot. Some biologists were walking through the garden, the Queen's garden. Queen's apparently got a big garden. And I'm sorry, Justin, I mistake. You do not need to go to London. This is in Edinburgh, Scotland.
Oh, what?
In Edinburgh, Scotland.
It's pronounced Burr, Edinburgh, Scotland.
Yeah, so anyhow, what they discovered in there, in Scotland, right where you are right now, in the Queen's Gardens, they found two Wentworth elms.
So thought to be totally extinct.
Yep, thought extinct, thought long gone, and apparently they're there. They're there in the garden, probably just a stone's throw from you. My point is, we don't know what else is in that garden. We don't know what other extinct species could be hidden there. I'm going to ask you a question, just a hypothetical question. If I were to go look at, like, the Scottish flag, and I were to go look at what sort of emblem was on there, what would I see?
Isn't it just the white X?
Well, what's the wasn't there another? Isn't there, like, a mascot? Isn't there, like, a special?
There's a Scottish royal lion.
Hold on. Let me get the correct terminology here.
Are we scrambling for all kinds of things? Are we trying to figure out things about Scotland to suppose they might be underneath this elm?
What is Scotland's national animal?
I think ancient forgotten haggis.
No! No.
No? Sorry.
No. No.
Okay.
Type in Scottish national animal into Google so I don't have to tell you this.
Okay.
All right. Oh, this I actually do know. No, the national animal is the unicorn.
You can't do that. You can't. What?
Wait, when was, how long is the unicorn, the unicorn, how long has the unicorn been the national animal of Scotland?
I don't know, a long time,
since
you know, we should ask our expert on the ground. So, my point is,
since the
12th
century.
Oh, wow. Oh, guys, yeah, it was used on an early form of the Scottish coat of arms. Wow.
So what I'm saying is that they found in the Queen's garden in Scotland extinct trees they thought were gone, but she'd been scrolled them away, hiding them away from everybody until a couple botanists going along
all right,
there.
No, this is making sense, actually. Now I'm seeing what you're – I'm picking up what you're putting down. I mean, we know for a fact unicorns used to be, you know, everywhere in Scotland. Otherwise, why would they put it on their flags and such?
Dude, I mean, Brian, I'm going to bring this back to reality here.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe there are unicorns in the garden. Maybe in a stable, maybe a secret stable. Maybe she rides them around on some special day. Rich people are weird.
Yeah. No. I mean, think about it. If you have one, you're not going to tell the world. It's there's going to cause trouble for you.
You're going to have to let all the poor children pet it, etc.
That's true.
I mean, I'm just saying. They're going to want to get in on this action.
I want Justin to go do an investigation. Maybe if they can go visit the grounds there, maybe go look for a horse stable and look for some holes in the roof.
Well, just evidence. Look for the kind of things you would expect to see if a unicorn had been there recently.
Is the stable roof leaking? You know what I'm saying? Like little holes were poked in there? Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
No, that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Right?
It'll be funny if oddly enough, the whole staff has been here for decades, except for one area that always can only be staffed by virgins.
Well, the good news is half our Weird Things listeners can then go there.
Oh, damn!
Oof-a-doofa.
Pure Upsoul. By the way, I'm watching. I'm getting a view of Bryce's control board with the Windows update, And watching Bryce work and do the behind the scenes is fascinating and should be a podcast unto itself. It is like some sort of fast forward, whatever, you know, like a Photoshop tutorial, you know, at 10 times the speed.
All right. I'll tell you what I want at 10 times the speed is this bicycle that I want to ride across to the American Southwest desert.
Oh, it's Journey Quest time. All right. Justin will get back to us about the unicorn hunt. Fine.
Yeah, no. I'll be. Listen, I got a train out of here at 11, but I'll try to squeeze it in.
Man, what happened to you?
I mean, I think you know what. Hey, man, if they're anywhere in the area, you know, they're magical creatures. My guess is that Justin's going to find a number of strong evidence that they've been. Yeah. Oh, I'm sure they're maggoty with unicorns.
Yeah. Where were we in Journey Quest? Do you remember? Do you remember what happened last?
Well, we were about to see a room. We had made it to a cave at the end of our bicycle pedaling extravaganza, where we escaped a bunch of raucous pregnant Amazon women, and we had finally made it to a cave. It turns out the guy's a fan, and he was going to take us to another cave, and
you had Vision Quest.
Oh, that's right.
You had the Vision Quest.
We got Wicked High. That's what it was. Yeah.
And you each had a vision, Brian. Do you recall your vision?
Oh, that's right. You each got personalized information about the other person.
Yeah.
Brian, you had a vision. You saw yourself in some sort of exalted position, perhaps we'll describe. You had an idea of Justin, perhaps a warning.
Yeah. No. I mean, in my vision, which I just assume is true, I don't want to turn on Justin, but let's just say my vision did not entirely fill me with confidence about my partner.
Justin, you recall your vision, perhaps?
I do not recall, because I think I'm also getting it mixed up with another another vision that I had during another similar thing that we did recently.
You had a vision of Brian, and perhaps you come across some refugees who are driving north to try to survive the apocalypse, and you had a vision of Brian's reception to them and perhaps a growing suspicion of his motivations.
Yeah, that's ringing a bell.
Yeah, I think that Brian might kill a new person, a newcomer possibly. There was murder potentially involved.
Not in my vision. Yours. Hey man, I'm just gonna lay it on the table. I had a wicked high trip, and it turned out that I was leading people. I had a whole tribe of people who believed in me, and then
you were on top of a pyramid, Brian, on a throne. Don't forget that.
You're damn right, because I was. First of all, everybody's riding bicycles as far as the eye could see. Totally green energy, silent.
Wait, Brian. They're not bicycles. They're Brian-sicles.
Okay, that's...
Our bicycles.
Yeah, I would imagine we call them bicycles in honor of...
For some reason, I can get down with that name a little bit better, huh?
There was about 300 people died in that argument over Brian-sicles versus bicycles.
there was a sect of people, as I told them about the dark producer Bryce and his mischievous ways and why you shouldn't trust him.
And I
the guy that murdered all those people in the hospital?
Yeah.
Oh God.
Wait, what happened?
The monster Bryce.
When I killed a bunch
of
kids.
Yeah, oh, yeah, no, I still haven't heard that.
Just following orders, Castillo.
at any rate, in my vision, not only did it say that I would be an awesome leader that was well-beloved by my community, but turns out there's a bit of a little J.I. in the mix, as in Judas Iscariot Young. I'm talking about you.
I think my vision was that you... We're gonna go power mad and murder people.
that's what all the JIs say.
Yeah. Well, number one, that's what my vision was. Like you don't have to murder people.
Yeah, you know what? Now that I'm thinking about this, it occurs to me that maybe the two of us could just talk about our visions and not accept them as the current reality. And in fact, maybe what we'll say is, I'm hearing you correctly. You say I should look out to make the mistake of being an egomaniacal, overpowered warlord. And you're saying, and I'm saying to you, don't cross me. Right?
Yeah, I guess that kind of gets to the short and sweet of it, doesn't it?
All right, well, let's file that away under things we should watch out for in the future if they do happen to come true. But in the meantime, I'm thinking maybe we should get some fresh water, pack our backpacks, and maybe start bicycling.
You're standing in front of the last, where we left off, your host in the cave, the guy that rescued you and pulled you to safety. I think his name, we called him Joe.
Sure.
Pulled a gun. He's holding on to the gun.
Yeah.
A gun in front of you all.
Yeah.
Right? It was a very tense moment, and we ended on that. He drew the gun. He's like, listen, you can question these prophecies as much as you want.
Oh, good. As long as we're questioning, Justin, have you ever done an illicit drug and had a trip and then that came exactly true? Because that doesn't even happen in my dreams. Like, I'm starting to think about it, and it's like the idea that just because you picture a thing, that means it's going to happen, that seems pretty silly.
That's not a thing, Brian. Like, it doesn't happen.
Well, let's recall.
Joe, hold on one moment.
I got a gun here.
That's cool. But, and by the way, as I start telling this story, I slowly and very bigly wink over at Justin. Like, hey, man, no, Justin and I are having an argument here.
Bang!
Biggity bang! And so
who does he shoot?
Who does he shoot?
Himself.
Oh my God!
Puts the gun to his chin, blows a bullet through his head.
And so this is the part where I turned to Justin. I was like, all right, number one, that was way louder than I expected it to be. That was really weird. Number two, I had this whole plan figured out where we're going to pretend.
Screaming. Oh my God! What just happened? Why did that just happen? That's insane. Brian, that man murdered himself in front of us. For what reason?
I said, that's a good point. And now that we have a new world order, we need to hold him at trial for the murder of himself. And so I start moving boxes over, and I set up a judge's pulpit.
I slap Brian across the face and say, come on, just let go of the bit for 5 seconds. We need to get on the goddamn road here.
All right, fine.
So... meanwhile, the guy's on the ground and he's gurgling and he's actually starting to whisper something.
I lean over and look like I'm trying to hear his whispers, but what I'm really doing is just peeling the gun out of his clenched fist.
Fine, but he lets you have the gun, and then he takes a crooked finger and points towards Justin. Then he whispers this into your ear, which you're going to get via text message. It's really weird. He actually texted you.
Okay, so I listen. I lean over. And I listen and I hear him whisper some stuff to me, and I say, and I look pointedly over at Justin with a slightly hardened stare, but then also I roll my eyes, and then I hear the rest of the message that just arrived on my phone. and then I'm just like, oh, and I look and I was like, hey, Justin, we got to get on the road. What do you say we start pedaling?
Remember, there's a busload of refugees that you heard about on the radio that need help.
Yeah. Well, let's get pedaling. We got a gun now. Let's just go, and we'll have bro talk while we're pedaling down the road.
All right, let's go. Let's go get that van.
All right, so you leave the still gurgling, not quite dead man to die on the floor of this cavern, even though he saved your lives and rescued you. That's fine. He's there.
I mean, he also shot
himself in the head,
yeah,
man.
Look, this is a libertarian paradise I've always wanted. He owns his own life, and he made the conscious decision to take it. So, I mean, it's like it's not my right to force him to live if he doesn't want to live.
Right, we gotta have a conversation at some point in this infinite time that we're gonna spend together about the differences between the terms libertarian and anarchy.
It's funny. we're pedaling along, and I'm like, hey man, you ever wonder what caused the whole apocalypse?
Sure, yeah, of course.
I mean, because I heard, I mean, it was so, have you heard any rumors?
No, I heard it was a super flu that killed a bunch of people.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, since when has a super flu killed millions of people? Can you name one time?
Like the plague?
Yeah. I guess also the Spanish flu from the early 20th century.
So, those times.
You know, it's like, I don't know, maybe I'm just noodling in the head, but it's like, I heard a rumor going around.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, people are talking, and a person, I'm not going to say who, but this person pointed a crooked finger at me and whispered something in my ear, and it was hard to hear.
Crooked finger at Justin.
There was so much gurgling. There's a lot of people who speak through blood choked sputters, and this person, whoever it was, maybe said, hypothetically, you know what caused the apocalypse.
Wait, all right. So the person who just impulsively blew their own head off.
I didn't say who it was. I said it was a person. It could be
anybody. It kind of like went more through their mouth and maybe the occipital lobe, but not quite fully blowing out the back of the head, just to clarify.
But also, I didn't even say it's that guy. Also, who's that voice? but yes. I mean, look, I heard that you know what caused the apocalypse.
Okay. Well, Brian, I got to tell you something. Because this is all kind of coming back to me.
Oh, well.
But there was a part of my vision. This was a part of my vision that I didn't tell you about. I knew, or I had a vision that you were going to accuse me that I knew what started the...
Wait. Wait, so are you saying the thing that I proposed, that like you had a dream and then it actually came true, that actually happened?
It's happening right now.
Wait, so, but is this like a deja vu thing? Because sometimes I have deja vu and I think like, oh, I dreamed this, didn't I? But then it's like, I can't really predict. Like, what happens next?
What happens next is we just go to that refugee van and we just figure it out. I mean, like, whatever. Listen, there's a lot of these weird prophecies that are swirling around us right now. But at the end of the day, either we're going to run out of food, we're going to run out of water, we're going to run out of medical supplies, or someone's going to shoot us. So the best thing we can do is try to keep going to L.A.
All right, let's keep riding, and I'll tell you what I'll do. Sometimes, you know, you know a thing, but you don't really know a thing, and you think you don't know a thing, but you really do. So I'm just going to try at random moments. I'll just kind of ask you, what started the apocalypse? And then maybe it's, like, subconsciously buried in you, and then you're just like, I did.
How the hell would I know what started the apocalypse?
I mean, the guy, he pointed his crooked finger. I mean, and plus your vision predicted this moment. Maybe there's something to it. Maybe it's a repressed memory.
Also, by the way to sell out that guy.
I mean, whoever that guy was, I don't. Ah, damn it, damn it. All right.
Hey, are you gonna go towards the bus or not?
Yeah,
we're going. Yeah. We're going right now.
Yeah, we're all pedaling.
Right. So you're pedaling along. You're coming up towards a steep sort of incline over a precipice, and your bicycles are, you know, managing. Your calves are burning a lot, though, and I forgot. Are these like 10-speed, 12-speeds, or they're just like single or fixed gear?
Yeah, they're like trail bikes. I don't think fixed gear would be really good for off-roading, but yeah, they're trail bikes.
Okay, all right. So you're reaching towards the top, and you hear the sound of a lot of motorized vehicles. A lot of motorized vehicles. Okay.
Which direction? In the direction we're headed, or?
Yep. The direction you're headed. You park your bikes, and you crawl over to the edge of the cliff, and you look down, and you see this sort of little flatland there. Mm-hmm. There's a school bus. Filled with people who are panicked. They're looking out the window because surrounding them is the armada that you just escaped from.
Justin, I feel like maybe we had some small hand in causing this problem to occur for these guys.
Yeah. Well, wait. All right. So they're all broken down?
Well, there's a school bus filled with refugees, and they're being surrounded by the marauding group of pregnant women in
the
truck.
Pregnant. We don't know that. We know that they're engineers and very, very mechanically inclined.
Got it. But the point is, like, I think we might have led them randomly on a goose chase. They were chasing us, and now all of a sudden, they're definitely harassing the school bus full of people. Maybe they're going to die.
All right. Are you ready for this? And you got his bicycles. You just got bicycles, right? And you see them sort of surrounding them, driving around, kind of like, Mad Max 2 style.
Sure. No, I do have that handgun. It's semi-automatic handgun. Right.
Get a handgun. There's about 25 vehicles, but you hear a rustling sound. It's this rustle, this tarp. Right?
Okay.
And you look over to the side, there's something covered. Something covered with the tarp, a big structure.
Wait, is it near us, or is it down there by
near them? Near you. It's right on the cliff with you. Right on the cliff with you.
Hold on. Hey, Justin, I'm sorry. I got to figure out what this rustling is. So I walk over, I grab a corner of the tarp, and I tug it. But it seems like, hey, Justin, this is harder to pull than I thought it would. Will you grab the other end?
All right. I go and I help Brian tug the tarp.
No, but not that end. Look, if we're pulling opposite. It's not going. Here, walk around on this side, and I'm going to flip it. We're going to go my right hand, your left hand, and we're going to both pull on three, okay?
Okay.
All right, ready? One,
two, three.
No, not now. I mean, we're going to go one, two, three, and then pull. You're pulling it two. All right, you know what? Here, get on this side. And I'm going to, I'll do this for an hour. we pull the tarp off.
What? Okay, sure.
What do we see?
You see. What you see before your eyes is a prototype. Lost, forgotten in time for almost 50 years. Right? Abandoned, left to be. But there it is, right now in front of you looks functional. It looks like it could totally function right now. And maybe you don't know exactly how you're going to use this, but perhaps you're seeing the germs of a plan start to form. What is before you right now is the prototype SkyCycle X2 that Evel Knievel was going to use to jump Snake River Canyon.
Oh my God. Okay. I turned to Justin and say, Justin, I think this might be the prototype SkyCycle 2 that Evel Knievel was going to use to jump to Snake River Canyon. And meanwhile, we're up here.
Like, that's amazing.
And it's like, hey, and also, if I remember correctly, Evel Knievel weighed about as much as the two of us put together, if I'm not mistaken.
Damn, we're thinning out.
Also, there's am I seeing this right, Andrew? It looks like there's a growler of what looks like unleaded fuel.
I don't know if that is what it ran on, but there's fuel. There's tanks.
There's tanks of fuel over here. And so describe for us what this vehicle looks like, just so I'm understanding it.
Imagine a missile.
Oh my God.
That you can sit in, and then maybe there's a couple little wheels on it.
Right on. Does it have wings?
I mean, it's got like little missile fins.
All right. And so let's just say this thing works. What can we do as we soar over this canyon that would scare off the technicians?
Well, so are we trying to get away, or are we trying to save these people?
Yeah, I want to save them. I mean, if you want to run away, then that's, I mean, we could talk about that.
No. All right, so we're gonna just set off the SkyCycle X2 and just hope it distracts them.
Oh no, I was thinking like we ride this and then we just drop, you know, some bombs over them. Or maybe, better yet, what if everybody's gotten real superstitious since there's no more technology and no more internet to call us wrong? Maybe we could convince them that we're gods in a bush and then say, like, don't anger us. And then, you know, and then somebody walks too close. They're like, you've angered us. And then we launch it. And then they think, like, oh, maybe that bush is a god.
I mean, so, Brian, civilization fell apart, like, 2 months ago. Like, do you think that we've devolved into the gods must be crazy already?
I mean, I'm just saying, you know, I'm trying to think outside the box here. What do you think we should do?
I think, really, the only way either we try to trade it with the marauders or we try to use it as a distraction or as a way to rescue the people that they're circling. And of those three scenarios, I think the most likely is us probably trying to make it a gigantic distraction and then trying to get the hell out of here with the people in the van.
All right. Hey, Andrew, what can we see inside the school bus? Like, can we get an idea of the demographic of people in there?
I would say look like families, a lot of families, you know, young families, small children. There's a little boy waving to you from he sees you all the way up there on the hill as you try to decide what do you do. And he's just he's looking right at you. He's making eye contact with you, Brian.
I do mouthing. The thing where I put one finger to my lips and I go, shh, and then nod and slowly like it's going to be okay, kid.
And he's like, he writes on the window, but he's because he's like seven. He writes it backwards, not knowing that. He says, please don't let me die, Bri.
Yeah. Okay. All right. And then it's like,
he knows your name.
I gesture.
Oh, he just made the Diamond Club symbol.
Okay. I'm gesturing in a counterclockwise motion as if to say, wipe that off. I don't want to. That's
now
bad.
He's making a gun with his hand. And he's like pretending to shoot at the people, the marauders who are surrounding the vehicle and points to you and is asking you to shoot them.
Is there any way
now
for
he picks up his baby sister who's maybe 2.5 years old, you know, and she's got a little jury shirt on.
Oh, man. Justin, I really feel like we should save these guys. I feel like that's the alpha and omega. Is there any way to tell, like, does it look like the bus is broken down? Is there a reason they're not
driving? Yeah, there's,
off?
Like, smoke coming out of the radiator. And maybe they just need some parts. Maybe they need some radiator hose or whatever.
And we're looking at how many bad guys?
I mean, they're like 20, 30 vehicles driving around. Really cool.
Man.
Plus, I think Bryce is like, you know, in a suit on the front playing an electric guitar, you know. What do we have him playing? The banjo. Electric banjo is their Duke Warrior.
What are you feeling, Justin? I don't know. Do we walk down and try to reason with them?
I mean,
because we don't got.
Oh, wait. There's somebody running across the plane, the desert plane towards them, holding his hands up, waving to them, right? It's this Bernie Sanders, nice looking man, says, "Why can't we just rip?" And they just blew him away.
Oh, jeez. No, yeah, they're definitely. This is bad.
They just ran over his body. They ran over it again. They keep running over him. It's flattening. They just smashed the head,
look,
too.
Look, Justin, all right, there's only one thing to do, Brian.
This is a big smear across there.
We got to buzz these bitches and then circle back because we have the faster vehicle and help out the people in the van. But we got to draw them away.
Buzz?
Okay. Here we go. So is there a direct route from the Sky Cycle from our current position down there, or do we have to come around another way, or?
Brian, I'm not sure you understand how a Sky Cycle works all of a sudden.
No, because my plan is we go and we attract them. We're like, hey, we're up here, come get us. And then they all come get us, and they're all like, fly this thing down there.
No, Brian, we're going off the edge of the cliff.
Well, that's what, okay. Again, my plan is to lure a bunch of them over, and then,
we
sky cycle down there.
Brian's onto something here.
Yeah, right? Or, maybe we wait.
So, Brian, your goal is you want to antagonize them, get them all en masse to come up to your position.
That's what I'm saying.
And as soon as they're there, hit ignition on the sky cycle, launch up into the air.
Yes.
Land near the bus, maybe quickly fix the radiator hose, right. Do whatever you can.
Sure. Yeah. No, that's exactly it. That's exactly what I'm getting at. Justin, are you down for this?
Let's go.
All right. I guess do we save? That seems like a good cliffhanger moment for us. That's
literally a cliffhanger moment. We'll find out next week on Journey Quest. What happens to their plan? Does it work? Does the sky cycle blow up? Do they suffer the same fate that Evel Knievel did, where he said it was a malfunction, although Bob Chirac, the designer, said it wasn't? Who knows? We'll find out. Journey Quest Extreme.
I'm excited.
Dude, all about it.
So, gentlemen, do we have any picks? Any picks?
Dude, I am just flooded with picks. I can't, it's hard for me to pick one, but I guess I'll do an easy one. I accidentally pirated a movie. I didn't know I was pirating it, but there was a top Reddit post that says, hey, this movie's out. And so I clicked on it and I watched the movie. And then afterwards I read the comments because I want to know what other people thought. And they're like, yeah, can't believe it leaked before its theatrical release.
Oh my God.
And I was just like, oh man, did I just buy it? Oh, damn it.
So it was like a screener. It was good quality.
It was perfect quality.
Okay.
It was news making torrent freak. We're trying to figure out if this is even an intentional leak or whatever. But I'm not gonna say what it is because I'm embarrassed. Instead, I'll just say how great Westworld is. Westworld is a really good show. I'm one episode in, and I like it a lot.
Cool. I'm at that point where I'm sort of waiting for like a bunch of episodes to back up before I start to watch it.
That's probably a good idea. It's just, I'm just glad to have something to watch weekly with Bonnie and a reason to still have my HBO account. And it seems like he's doing it.
Westworld, the original was written and directed by Michael Crichton. And, dude, I'm a big fan. I think we're all big fans of him. That guy was ahead of his time in so many ways. And that was a theme.
As a matter of fact, in the movie, they talk about a bug that propagates from robot to robot as if like an infection, foreshadowing.
In the original, yeah.
Yeah, foreshadowing. This is back in the 1970s, foreshadowing the real phenomenon of computer viruses before that was a thing.
Yep, and it's amazing how much how prescient he was about those things, or understood what curtain problems were in technology that just you weren't reading about in popular entertainment. And he revisited that idea, you know, it was about 10 years later or so, he was just really toyed with the idea again of trying to do a theme park that went awry. And that's when he started thinking about, he wanted to do the story of, you know, dinosaurs. And so eventually that became Jurassic Park. You know, he went about it from a different point of view. And so I think, you know, it's neat to go watch the original version. The original version you can get, I still think, is on iTunes for like $6. It's not a...
Think it might be free on Amazon.
Oh, even better. So it's an odd movie, and then it's not a Western. It's not a full-on sci-fi movie. It's a bit of the 70s sort of nihilistic kind of thing in some regards. And so it does a few different things, but ultimately it's still a lot of interesting thinking went into it. And I'm gonna say check out the movie. And I'll have our two, but I have a pick after yours, Justin.
My pick is something that I watched on the way over here to the UK. It is a movie that came out this year, a little independent film called Sing Street. It's an Irish movie, but the director's done a bunch of stuff, recently that are usually all musical based. But Sing Street was a really like a fun, catchy, awesome little movie where about a bunch of kids in Ireland who want to start a band in the 80s and sort of everything that goes along with like that process up to and including, every time a new music video comes on MTV, the lead singer kid who's our protagonist winds up changing the sound of the band, which is, you know, a fun kind of comedic device to watch. And then, by the end, as his band has kind of become fully formed, it really is this sort of hybrid sound of all the bands that had been that he'd been listening to and being influenced by, and the music's good, the acting's good, it's well directed, and I very much enjoyed it. Sing Street.
Cool.
My pick is one of my favorite films, and I'm actually listening to the audiobook of the story. It was based on the short story by Rudyard Kipling, and that is The Man Who Would Be King. It stars Sean Connery, Michael Caine. And it was directed by the
John Huston. John Huston.
Thank you. I always get John Huston confused with John Ford. So John Huston directed it. Great director. And just an amazing, just a really neat story. So it's the story of these two former British officers in India who are a bit of scam artists who decide that they're going to try to take over an actual country, Kafiristan. And it's actually based on, in part, on a couple real events that took place in the early part of the 19th century. And it's a quirky, fun movie. I think that it's a great Sean Connery performance, by the way, too, because he plays, you know, this sort of goofy, sort of oddball Brit, which is not unlike some of his he did like a pre James Bond film or around that time too. What's it called? I got to pull up the name of this title because it's like the trailer for that film is just incomprehensible to an American like myself who has no grasp of that period. So this was called what was that one called? Sorry, as I try to look this up right now. But I highly, highly, highly recommend The Man Who Would Be King because it's just, I think, just a really good, and Michael Caine is just always, always really, really good. So, what is, I don't even see it in here. I watched the trailer for this the other day. It's like called like In the Fiddle or something. Like, it's just one of those kinds of weird sort of British things about a couple of British officers in World War II. And I had like an Alan King guest appearance to it. But anyhow, any of you guys ever see The Man Who Would Be King?
No. As a matter of fact,
I have not. No.
I totally thought it was going to be something about King Arthur. And then I was like, wow, that's not at all what I thought it was. Sounds great.
On the Fiddle. That's the movie I was trying to remember too. It's On the Fiddle. Like if you can see the trailer for On the Fiddle, I mean, it's just like, it is so colloquial sort of British slang in the way that it's presented. But Man Who Would Be King, by the way, that's kind of, he plays sort of what a kind of a similar character, I think, a little bit to On the Fiddle, but a really, really neat performance. It's just a fun, neat movie. And I mean, it's you know, ultimately a certain amount of gravitas to it. But Man Who Would Be King is my pick. Check it out. You can also get on Amazon the Kindle version. It's a short story. It's not that long. You can get the audiobook for like 95 cents if you want to listen to that version of it. But the movie certainly has a lot more stuff in it. Christopher Plummer's in it. He's great. So
cool.
But yeah, just I know, can you play a little bit of the trailer of On the Fiddle, by the way? You just got to hear this. You just got to hear this.
Just jump to anywhere?
Yeah. Or is this the actual movie?
Now, if I was you, I'd have this monkey. It's got a coloured behind, see? And every time the flipping laugh wipe come at you, all you got to do is turn it around this way and say, kiss my...
I don't know what's happening. That didn't appear to be either. English. I never have so few fiddled so many...
7 days leave, $5, weekend pass, $0.50, excuse duty check.
Only one thing,
Bobby. Only what?
Aren't
what?
We going to fight anybody?
All right.
Ooh. Come along, all you old
soldiers. That was Sean Connery playing this sort of very goofy character. So that was...
Wow, dude. That is like a time portal to another dimension. Time travel's real, people. You want to go back and see how messed up it was?
Sorry for the sidejacking that, but my pick is The Man Who Would Be King by John Huston.
And got it.
There you go. Gentlemen.
Sweet.
It's been weird.
Hey, good show, guys. Do you have to bounce, Just?
Yeah, I probably could stand to bounce and just get prepared. I'm gonna try and pack up before I watch this debate here at 1 a.m.
Okay.
Is there a debate tonight?
Don't care.
Indeed, there is, Brian. Mm.
Well, then we'll let you go.
All right. Cheers, bruvs.
Let us know about the unicorn.
Yeah, dude. Look for unicorn evidence.
Chip, chip.
I will. All right. I love you guys. Choo-choo. Bye.
I don't think he is.
Wait, you don't think he is? I think he's going to be scanning at the airport for evidence of unicorns. Here, let me do a quick lap. Make sure nothing's on fire. I'll be right back.
Sure.
All right. Yeah, I watched the entire On the Fiddle trailer, and I do not know. I'm like, hey, there's Alan King.
It's also that, like, filmmaking at the time was so different, and was this a British production too? Like,
yeah,
it might as well be in a foreign language compared to. You know what we're
there were a lot of movies that came out before, but it was, you know, it's one of those sort of army comedy type films, but I think that it was some of the uses of the slang were just, you know,
it was of the time.
Yeah, very much of the time. But yeah, I'll be right back.
Yeah, go for it. There are a couple of good titles here on show, but we've got Excitement of Mourning, which I think is pretty cool. Phantom Pregnancy. You can sit in that monitor if you want to take a seat. The Moon Proposal Hoax I think is pretty good too. The Great Staten Island Ferry. My only thing about that is that it might give it away that it's kind of a weird thing. Bumps Mumble kind of didn't fit. I mean, it was appropriate, but also kind of not a part of this episode. Blood Chicks Butter. I like, what was Phantom, I don't remember Phantom Pregnancy being a thing. I like the Moon Proposal Hoax. We'll go with that. I know I already voted for that shot. Yeah, so I was talking to the guys, at the start of the stream that I was working on some new music. I can play it because I didn't. I realized I didn't put it online like I did the other one because it's like super. It's real simple. It's a but it's something that I enjoyed making. Here we go. And it's also not mixed. The woman. Oh, the 999 calls. I enjoyed the foundation element. I like the bottom of it, which I don't usually get in that position, but I need, like, just, it needs a face. It just needs a little bit of a face.
What?
This minor song.
What? Do we have questions this week?
We did not get any this week.
All right, I got topics for you, Brian.
All right.
It's going to be Mars themed.
Oh, dude, into it. Yeah, oh, yeah, we can kind of, I'd love to get a peek behind the curtain on.
On the new book.
On the stuff you're thinking of.
Yeah, we'll talk about that and talk about, you know. Oh, man. God darn it. Brian.
What?
I totally forgot to use my new way to end weird things.
Oh, what is it?
It's been weird.
I came up with this before the show started.
Nice.
Thank you very much. No. I apologize for making us watch the... On the Fiddle, but I was like, understand, late at night, Finnish man who would be king, and I see this movie by Sean Connery, never even heard of, and I'm like,
and you're like, and what you am see I him, looking at?
and you, like, you see him play these other bits in the where he's just this sort of, like, you know, like, very, like, playing this mildly dumb kind of guy, you know, this very sweet, sincere kind of, like, you know, at least in the trailer, and it was like, it's very different. One of the things, Man Who Would Be King, is just this really cool. You just get a really good sense of his goofy, you know, how he could play goofy really well.
Yeah.
I preferred when he played Pluto. They're Disney animals.
Wait, he did?
No. Bryce is just
okay. Because Goofy Bryce, is the name of.
Remember, this is the contingent that was seriously entertaining the idea that a giant octopus murdered 400 people. We have to conditionally just sort of go with anything that gets said here. It's like improv, you know?
Got it.
Sure. Yes and, but for conspiracy theories.
Yeah. All right, man. If we got a topic, let's dive in.
All right. Yep. Take it away in 3, 2.
Welcome to the After Things podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Brian Brushwood.
Yo.
Justin can't be here because he is on special assignment right now trying to investigate the Queen's Garden in Edinburgh.
I don't want to
looking for unicorns.
Yeah, well, and I don't want to say what our source was, but somebody intimated that there was a strong possibility that unicorns were afoot in Scotland, and so he's looking for evidence.
He promised us he would not come back to the show unless he brought back hard evidence.
Right on.
I mean, not. I mean, it was. He said it in his eyes.
I mean, it was implied, right? He didn't even need to say it. I think we gathered that was the case.
Yeah, and I think Brian, I think you're pretty astute.
Well, I think you're real tall. Do we have a question or a topic for After Things?
Okay, Brian, I see how it is. I understand.
It's fine.
I understand. Really, we're ultimately alone.
We don't need him. Anyhow, we don't need him.
First, Justin. Now you. I'm gonna just carry on the show like a professional. What a professional would do, and not air whatever sort of personal grievances we may have here. in the lack of reciprocity for compliments about one's intelligence. It's okay. Moving on. It's what a professional does, Brian.
It's good.
See what a professional does?
You're doing great. It's feeling very professional here, man.
So what I wanted to do was to actually hijack the discussion just a little bit, which is totally what I don't normally do on this show.
Right.
And we had a big epic discussion last week about the whole fact that Elon Musk, SpaceX have announced this whole architecture for bringing people to Mars. And one of the things that's sort of come out of that is that, you know, they were making the point of like, he was making the point of like, listen, like, hey, we've got this way to go to Mars. We're going to need a lot of participants and people to help us get there. And probably the biggest reaction has been, well, what are we going to do? How are we going to survive there? And he's kind of like, yeah, that's why I wanted to start the discussion so we could talk about this.
Right. And I guess that's the weird part is that it wasn't like he framed it like we're finally announcing our plans. Well, I guess they did announce their plans to go to Mars.
It was a complete thing, though. He didn't say it was like a whole complete mission.
Sure. Correct. No. I think they couched it correctly. But of course, you know, stuff gets whittled down and people only pay half attention. And then they have questions of like, oh, well, I wonder how many arcades will there be on each of the ships? And it's like, why aren't they answering the hard questions?
Yeah, it was the point of it was to start a discussion and try to figure out what are the next steps? What are the technologies we need? Because it's not going to be just one company that makes this thing happen. Mm-hmm. And it's been kind of cool if you follow reddit.com/r/SpaceX, you see there's a variety of discussions there. Some are, I would call, low information discussions where some of the people positing stuff, things like this, is as you describe, Brian, it's like they've only thought about it for a minute. And mm-hmm. then they're like, well, I think this. And then there are some really high information, high bandwidth discussions from people who've thought a lot about this. We've now seen people creating virtual simulations using everything from Kerbal Space Program to writing their own C programs to simulate different aspects of it. There are discussions now about what would you build? How would you flat pack? What kind of technologies are we going to need? And these discussions are starting from a low information point, but they're starting to move into a high information point. And this is what's cool is we're starting to see this sort of, oh, okay, if we know this is how we're going to get there, how do we solve all these other problems? And that was sort of the goal. And so I've been working on a book, and this started because I wrote an essay the week prior to the announcement trying to explain the economics of Mars and trying to articulate why we should go, not from some sort of high level, it's our destiny point of view, and not in some sort of far off, and then when we find unobtainium, it makes it all worth it, more in very grounded, practical arguments of why approaching Mars as the most important technology problem of our generation would lead to an incredible amount of economic gain, technological gain, and could be just a major driving force for the global economy moving forward in the 21st century.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. And we were talking about, like, I had posited, if nothing else, a truly, like, just as a data repository, you could charge a crap ton of money just to essentially take something that has no cargo space. You could charge a crap ton of money for truly secure transactions or whatever, where it's like, you know, by routing it through Mars and it's completely untraceable. Nobody will ever, you know,
you have to just be mindful though of like, of if you approach everything from a business point of view and say, okay, what is the cheaper alternative? And you could come up with 1,000 cheaper alternatives to that. You know, you come up with 1,000 things that would be cheaper than that. And so you have to kind of, you know, say, okay, what is inherent about this and nowhere else that you could then sort of build this upon?
Oh, that's interesting. So you're saying like, oh, if you want to get in the offsite, truly offsite data business, you'd find a closer asteroid or just send it to the moon or whatever.
Build some sort of secure sort of network on Earth or something like that. You know, yeah. I mean, but that's the way you have to sort of step into it, is you sort of say, okay, if I have money to invest and you come to me and say, okay, I want you to invest in this because we can do this, I'd be like, why don't we do this? And that's not to say that at some point, like, I get a bit into the discussion about kind of like finance in the sense and all that, like finance from the point of view of exploration. And if you have some sort of currency tied to Mars exploration or the value of transportation to Mars, then you can have those cool things like digital signatures or blockchains, et cetera, and all that. But it's a you know, anyhow, and that's what I try to do, sort of like say, okay, let's look at things that have worked in the past and how would you sort of base an economic argument on this? And the first thing we get into is the idea that, let's say we can send a rocket to Mars and we can return a payload from there. Payload from Mars to Earth is ridiculously expensive, you know, because you have to produce all of your fuel on Mars. So it's very, very, very expensive. But if you're, we'll call, I call it the Mars Exploration Corporation, MXC, we'll call it, which could be a partnership with SpaceX and other companies. If you're MXC and you're the only company that can go to Mars and back from Mars, bringing people and cargo, you have access to the most rare resource ever, which is just pure Martian material, pure Martian rock. You have iron on the surface of Mars that you could then go put, take that iron and put it into Rolex watches and come up with the Rolex Martian watch. And it only has a tiny amount of it, but much like markets on Earth for things like diamond and jade and all these sort of precious gems, you've got an extremely constrained commodity that you can then put into play in that place in the marketplace.
Man, that's challenging because it sounds like that sounds like a marketing move, and I know you've thought this out more than I'm hearing it for the first time, but it just sounds like a novelty marketing move. If we could do that today, we have rocks that were kicked off of the Martian surface, and we could,
do you know what they go for per ounce?
What's that?
Do you know what they go for per ounce?
What?
$20,000 an ounce.
Okay. Sure. Will it be substantially cheaper? Like, so let's say all of a sudden it's cheap to get Martian stuff to Earth. Wouldn't that just flood the market and nobody, like, what diamonds? Diamonds are unique because they are physically harder than any other mineral out there, and they also sparkle better than other whatevers. So it's not just the rarity of diamonds that make diamonds valuable. It's the functional aspects of them.
That's not quite the case. The global market, there's a global market for diamonds in the luxury market, and then there's industrial diamonds, which are lower cost, and the synthetics are actually better for industrial applications.
Sure.
And so, you take a market like jade, or you take markets or things like that that don't have the industrial applications.
Right. But is there anything besides, but this iron oxide came from Mars to it? Because if that's the case, that makes it a bubble, I assume a bubble fad, something susceptible just to the whims of like the novelty
can get. I think the initial phase it would be. And as we sit here, where the bubble fad of Bitcoin, which has only thing it has scarcity to it as a mathematical algorithm, is a $10 billion market. My point is that we can say the market for it will be non-zero. Okay. What the size of the market is another thing. And so I get into like how you build an early stage system to sort of speculate on what the value of. When you start to look at you and I are both not luxury goods people. We're highly functional people. But when we walk past a high-end department store complex like that, and they have the Gucci and all the other sorts of stuff, not a thing that's really in our purview. But when you look at it as a percentage of the economy, it's tremendous. And so I don't know what the worth of these things are, or what the value of this is, but when you start to look at the value of luxury goods and sort of it's a market that's driven by putting in the new or the exotic sort of materials, you know, there was a titanium craze for a while, even though the titanium that was actually used in these products provided no structural value to it, it was the new thing. So I say it's like, I think the market for this is non-zero. I think it could be a humongous market, but assuming just the smallest sort of kind of rose gold, whatever kind of thoughts of this, what, you know, where would the rich kids of Instagram and that sort of stuff drive those prices? And the idea is that's not what this industrial base is based upon. That's not what it's based upon. That's just the early stage of saying, okay, what are the first sort of areas of exploitation that you have before? Going back historically, whenever we open up new markets, you know, tulip bulbs, you know, were no practical apply to the food supply. They crazed a bubble and then a bust in the Dutch economy 200 years later in the Ottoman Empire. Again, it had this sort of thing. And then sort of my point of view is like, I would think that Martian material, even regolith, as being used in industrial, is using commercial products, would be a multi-billion dollar market. Not the biggest market will come out of Mars, which would be biotech and information technologies, but the first initial thing where people go, oh, I get that.
Okay. Man, it's I feel like I'm supposed to disagree or have another point or whatever, but I also feel like I won't get the full phrase out before you've already considered it. It seems to me like I don't know that everybody is bustling, saying like, man, life would just be so much better if we just had some Martian dirt. We got to unlock that Martian dirt and get out there and get it. But I do feel like there are people saying like, man, it'd be great if I could just grow my family in a government-free space or whatever. Like, I feel like there are needs now that going to Mars would unlock. You know, I think there are people saying, like, man, science would be so much better if we didn't have to send robots all the way to Mars, if we could just get there and look at the dirt right now. Like, those are the things that are the pressing reason to go to Mars. As opposed to, I do think that there will be a small export market, but like you were saying, I think it'll be a bubble that at some point will collapse once it's.
Well, and I guess I should preface that it's like when we talk about the future, you have to say at what stage is there? How do you derive value from that? The I'm going to move my family to Mars is 20 or 30 years away. If you say we can do a sample return in 9 years, and we can bring back, one metric ton of material. It's sure. Saying, okay, how do we first derive value from that?
And that does make a lot of sense. And I guess what's interesting is the restriction of thought, which I think is a smart thing to do, of you can't just assume there's something magically useful or helpful, some resource to be discovered over there. Whatever it is has to be valuable in and of itself. And certainly in that first wave, I think a bit of Martian material of any variety is part of it. But what else is on the menu besides the raw materials?
Well, the thing is that Mars is a horrible place for raw materials. It's a horrible thing to try to build anything where we're building on the idea of bringing things back from Mars because the costs are so high. And so one of my first proposals is just if we just in a understanding that at the very early stage you take the novelty, you capitalize on the novelty as part of it at the first phase, knowing full well, as you point out, that is a bubble. And I go into bubbles and explaining the tulip economies and Beanie Baby stuff and things like that, of how things that don't have intrinsic values, they burst and then that's gone and you can't expect to build that on it. And so I'm just primarily saying Your first sample return, this is how we pay for that. And that's how we build the steps to the next stages, which gets into colonizing Mars is a technology problem. There's a transportation. There's a human life support. There's all these problems we have to solve, all these different technologies. And I list about 65 different technology things that we have to solve in there that also have Earth applications. And as you develop those, you know, from the windshield glass we need to put on the spaceship, which then might be a better iPhone glass, to a better water filtration system that's 30% more efficient and energy efficient, has huge implications on Earth. And getting to the point that the real benefit comes from all the, you know, all the technology, just the development of a technology infrastructure.
So one of the criticisms has been like, goes back to like, you know, Carl Sagan says, hey, what you want to do is make Velcro and Tang. Why don't you just spend a fraction of that money to have a think tank that makes Velcro and Tang? Likewise, exactly. If what you want is better iPhone screens, why not just have a team to make better iPhone screens?
Oh no, I call that the tenuous Tang argument, and I have a big I fully agree that you and the problem is that if you want to solve that thing, then you spend. That's been the biggest problem. The NASA sort of argument is like, look, we got these things, but then he goes on to make this philosophical argument, which has not worked in almost 50 years. This you know, our hearts are sure we should go, command our destiny in space. Didn't motivate anybody for 50 years. So it's like, okay. And part of the problem too is that NASA as a technology transfer program is not the most efficient way to do it. Versus if you say, okay, to get to Mars, we need a reusable rocket system. So let's invest in methane rockets, which don't have the coking problems of it. You have a direct technology right there. Because now you can do low Earth orbit. So your first technology you need has immediate applications for launching low orbit satellites, for putting space stations into space, whatever. It's not and then we could do this. It's no, that technology is useful for that. Moving forward, if you say, okay, we need to develop more robust systems for space electronics and things like that, then your business is aerospace, these people who want to do space mining and all these other things. So it's saying these problems we're solving have direct applications, not just in Mars, but space exploration and technology.
Right. Well, so to the question of, I'm thinking in terms, you know, just to make this a little more after things, you know, your target demographic for the book, I assume it's written in theory as to the forward thinking, let's say 20-year-old who, you know, is going to have business opportunities presented in the next 10 to 30 years that are not now. In the short term, outside of waiting for the export from Mars of Mars stuff, what are some ways, I assume you've thought about this, that you can make money on just sending stuff to Mars?
Well, I mean, again, most of the book actually deals with the shorter term. It's not once we're there and we're building pizza parlors. It's the early stage stuff which is why I would have dismissed the whole idea of even bringing, you know, like the Martian dirt back. And that was a thing that if you presented that argument to me a month ago, I would have been very dismissive of it. But then once I started studying, you know, like the East India Company and then the patterns of all these other things and how that drives consumer goods, I'm like, oh, I mean, intellectually, this doesn't appeal to me because I think those things are silly, but then I'm overlooking an entire big market. So I get into like a lot of the shorter term stuff of problems that you need, you know, that we can start solving now that have sort of readier applications and saying, okay, if you have an interest, if we know that we're between Bezos and Elon Musk, you know, that they're planning to build these rockets and increase the amount of capacity we have there, is what would I want to do right now if I wanted to get involved in that industry? What skills should I consider developing? What areas are going to start having sort of the first, you know, the first influx of capital, et cetera? And a lot of it gets into CubeSats, things like that. And
sure, you know, sure. So I think I misinterpreted the title because with the title saying how to make money on Mars, and a guide to Martian economics, I guess I was thinking that it would mostly be about what money is on the planet Mars, but it sounds like we're talking about like how to make money on the race to Mars.
I mean, it's all about the you know, it's trying to deal with the idea of what does Mars mean as a, and from a business model case point. And I start off, I explain the first successful Martian startup, the first enterprise that was dedicated towards Mars, and how it's been extremely successful. And that was like going back in, let me pull up my notes here to get the date right. 1894
was the first, what again?
I call it the first Martian startup, the first Mars startup, 1894.
Okay.
And what it was is construction workers cleared the top of a mountain outside Flagstaff, Arizona territory, and it was the first Mars focused project. This financing primarily came from the hopeful exploration of Mars, right? And that was Lowell Observatory.
Okay. I got it. Yeah.
Percival Lowell was fascinated by Mars, thought there was intelligent life on Mars, and built an observatory to observe Mars. And he claimed he saw canals. Nobody else saw them. But that laboratory in over 100 years has employed thousands of people, thousands of astronomers, staff, whatever. It's done an incredible amount of research. Clyde Tombaugh was able to discover Pluto from there. We noticed the recessional velocity of the galaxies, which showed us the universe was expanding. More recently, they may have detected the atmosphere of an exoplanet. They just built a $53 million telescope in conjunction with the Discovery Channel. So it's sort of an idea of trying to explain that, like, you have to look at it. It's not really like, oh, we get this thing here and we bring it back and we make money. It's all the sort of lateral ways in which things do that. You create an entire economy. You know, the economy of an Android phone isn't just you buy the phone. There's the service that goes to the phone. There's the apps that go to the phone. There are all the other things that run over the phone that you, from having mobile computing and all these sorts of things that make that possible. So,
right. Right. No, that's fascinating. So you said this was originally just an essay you started writing beforehand?
Yeah, I was trying to do kind of like an essay, start off with sort of a business case of looking at, like, you know, what when you, because I hear you hear sort of thing like, oh, well, we're not going to get anything from there. And it's like, well, yeah, you're not going to get like the idea of, I have a whole thing explaining why we're not going to find, you know, trying to find unobtainium there is really pointless and not really the goal anyways, because from an economic point of view, finding one particular mineral or resource at the expense of everything else, you have not as well, not your, your long-term economic development isn't as much as if you have a technology base.
Yeah.
And so the idea is just sort of trying to explain, like, look at it as like, look at Mars as the epitome of developing space tech. We have computer tech right now space tech, you know, you have biotech, the technology of biology, and Mars is the idea of space technology, developing all these technologies for going out and developing space.
Right on. Well, so when, how far along is it? Like,
I mean, the book is finished. I'm going through my revisions on it right now and putting that together. So it comes out on the 31st. So, but I mean, like, and you know, talking to you and like, that's helpful. It's absolutely helpful because it's this, I don't want to put my arguments out there in a vacuum and then go, and then I'm right. You know, is that it's, I need to build a very good case for it. Our cases where I may have overlooked something and be able to go, oh no, you know, I was wrong. I found that a number of my assumptions about, you know, that I've in doing research, I'm like, oh, you know, I thought this, but now I see that there's, you know, a different approach towards it. And there's not been, there's almost like really nothing that's ever done. If you look in space economics or anything like that, there's stuff that will talk about the existing sort of industry, but there's not a lot of stuff that talks about how you take what we've learned in tech industry and apply to it, because it's still that old space model. You know, if we go there once, you know.
Right. And then, so now that you have the text done, but you're, you know, obviously you're mentioning that you have revisions, like, do you have a method of kind of alpha, having alpha readers give it a once over, or just do you have a testing set that you do?
Yeah, I'm going to try to get some samples out to people on my email list who want to take a look at it and read through it. That would be ideal. That would be the goal, would be able to have that do that. And it's, I have friends who are in very, you know, been active in the space industry and stuff in different sort of levels and things like that, that I've been giving them pieces to read and stuff. And as consequence of that, I've been invited to a lot of cool things now because of that.
That's cool.
Be able to talk about later. So, cause part of it is like, I've had the reactions been like, wow, you know, this has not been, haven't read anybody actually think about it at this level of take like a modern contemporary economics approach to look at it, understanding what the technology is at present.
Do you think when you wrote this book, I mean, obviously it was written because of the SpaceX event, so it's very timely right now. Do you think it's the kind of thing that will get more interesting as it gets closer? Because you're so early on this sort of public discussion that this has the chance to be the starting point for arguments to come for the next decade.
I would like to see the conversation start to shift. And I, you know, cause it's, you and I watch the Elon Musk talk, things like that. We get the economic point. We understand the idea of why reusability is absolutely critical. And you and I see the longer term to get from here to the 100-year history of Mars, the 100-year future of Mars. You need to have this thing. You can't just wait and hope that it comes about, that reusability or some sort of technology comes along. That's still a thing that a lot of people don't. And reading the reaction to the announcement, you know, from people like who I highly respect, like Robert Zubrin and others, who are still looking at it like, well, if we do this, we can get there faster. And it's like, yeah, but you just left you're putting a habitat in a cyclical orbit. You don't get to use. You can't replenish. It maybe doesn't make as much economic sense. Or you're getting these sort of arguments or things where people are still not really understanding the economic case for it, because it's. I think for a lot of engineers, it's kind of more about the hardware and not necessarily about the economics of it. But if you can marry the two, then that's where it gets helpful. So what I hope is just to sort of get people into the mindset of saying, let's discuss the economics of this in a sort of a rational sense. Let's get rid of some of the sillier or the notions that won't make as much sense, like trying to find a magic material, trying to base it all on these, oh, maybe we'll find life. Maybe if we find life, the biotechnology implications are immense. But I don't even base the case on the book. Like, and if we find life, you know, this justifies so many things. It would, but that's a very high risk thing. And I don't, you know, like tourism. I'm like, I mean, Mars tourism, you know, it's a 3-year round trip. I don't see that as being a viable thing for a considerably long period of time.
Right. So Open Bayou in the chat asks, how much of your research is from the 1600s to 1700s on the success and failures of exploring a Western route to China and finding the new world? Do you rely heavily on precedents?
So, I mean, I don't, the trying to, you don't need, I don't think we know the route to Mars. You know, we know the path to there. The thing that interests me more is taking, let's say in 1600, when the East India Company formed a joint stock corporation to go exploit the resources in India. That's interesting because that's a, okay, kind of routes. We sort of had an idea what the routes were, whatever. And we had this idea that we saw some resources and what were going to happen. How do you develop an infrastructure to develop that? That's interesting to me. The percentage of trade goods that have no industrial applications is really, really fascinating to me, because when you look at it's historically the number of things that we brought back from, you know, other places at great expense, the number of them that actually had commercial applications were much lesser. They were more about luxuries and things that we just enjoyed and stuff. Because
well, yeah, like the entire spice trade, it's like, you know, way more valuable per ounce than gold for a long time.
Yeah, yeah, and you can argue that sort of limited the more kind of perhaps was making really bad food palatable, which certainly maybe helped health. But yeah, it's one of those examples of spice, silks, you know, oils, things like this. So much of these things the trade was based on were not practical goods. They were goods purchased by the affluent. And to think that that wouldn't be a part of initial development, again, understanding bringing stuff back from Mars, super, 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 super expensive. So it's not like we're going to go there like, look, we found gold. Like, who cares? It's like, oh, it's a special Martian gold. And who's going to want to buy a Martian band that's made from this? And
right.
I don't know the answer. I know it's non-zero.
Dude, do you want to jump into some picks here? Because I have a tactical question about how you're selling it. I noticed you're not calling this a Kindle single, right? It's how big is it? It's listed at $3.99.
Yeah, it's the final version's going to be like 50,000 words, so like 180 pages.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So that's bigger than a single. This recently I read my first Kindle single, and that's my pick. John Ronson wrote a book called The Elephant in the Room, and it's you could buy it for $1.99, or you get it for free if you already have Amazon Prime. And I found myself for the first time installing a reader, because like if I could have, I would have loved to have just read it as a web page, but that's, you know, complicated to monetize. So I actually downloaded the Kindle reader on the computer so I could read it. But it's all about John Ronson, who of course wrote The Psychopath Test and a number of other fascinating books. It turns out he knew Alex Jones in the 1990s, and it was his suggestion that, you know, he knew Alex Jones just as this, you know, right-wing Austin cable access personality who was talking about the possible, you know, cabal of conspiracy of wealthy, you know, proto-Illuminati stuff. I don't really understand all of it. But basically, there's some event that they would do where a bunch of old rich white dudes would gather in the forest, and they had some – they would throw an effigy of some – dummy that was supposed to represent, you know, not capitalism, and then they would you know, they do their silly song and dance, and then they go home. Well, John Ronson was like, we should try to crash that thing if it's real, and we should go do it, and they did. And Alex Jones smuggled in a camera in a gym bag and got footage of it. And it's fascinating to see, number one, they obviously ended up going very, very different career paths. And this book started off as an attempt for John Ronson to catalog, you know, his attempt to penetrate the alt-right movement. And along the way, he found himself in the same place at the same time as Alex Jones. And it's told kind of in two threads, one in the beginning of their relationship in the 1990s, brief as it was, and then now with the, you know, reconnection that they're having. And it is it was a fantastic read. It was really, really a fantastic read, and it's totally free if you have Amazon Prime.
Very cool. Very cool. Yeah, it's a very interesting model they're trying to do for shorter form. I think there's a lot of opportunity out there for that. I thought my book was going to be short, and then it kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger.
Yeah, I don't know how many. Is there a way just from looking at this to get a sense of how big it is?
48 pages, roughly 200 words per page, roughly ish. So it's about 10,000, 12,000 words.
Okay. Yeah, right on. Right on.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's an awesome read.
My pick is there's been a lot of new features in OS X with the iPhone. And one of the things that I am using much, much more now because it does a lot of things is the Notes app. And I don't know if you've had a chance to play with it, but like the little drawing function in there has been very useful. So a lot of times if I need to do a quick sketch, I pull up the drawing app and I will draw a picture. You can actually share things with people if they're logged into iCloud, so you can have other people contribute and be part of that. And I found that it's become a... I've gone through a lot of different like note-taking apps and stuff, but now I keep using this more and more and more. So my pick is if you're on iOS and you have iOS 10, go play around with notes. You might find it's more useful than you recall.
Right on. Good pick.
Groovy. I would say it's been after.
Would you?
Yeah. Would you? I could.
Cool.
Has that Valve conference happened yet?
Valve conference?
Yeah. Valve is supposed to have some kind of thing where they talk about what they're up to, and there's all this speculation about how much, you know, what they're going to announce for the Vive and so on. Somebody recently made a video saying, please, please focus on these aspects and so on.
I typed in Valve conference, and I think I got two different conferences about valves and flaps. So I don't 100% know that that's probably not what I'm
That's looking. Actually valves.
Well, and I typed Valve.
Steam Dev Days. That's what it is. Days. Steam Dev Days.
Yeah, let's see. Dev Days. Oh, wow. That's right. They hadn't done this since 2014. Though last time they did it in 2014, they announced the Steam machines, the whole standardized.
And as we all know, they took the market by storm. Yeah.
October 12th through the 13th. So that's in a couple of days.
Okay, right on. Yeah, because there's, man, it's like the Vive. there's one video where the guy did a really good job of pointing out, like, in the early days of black and white television, RCA understood that it's like it doesn't matter how good it is if there's nothing to watch. So they opened studios and they really fostered a lot of effort to make content. Whereas with the Vive, it's the equivalent of them coming out with a full color television in 1951 and then just saying, like, I don't know, you guys make programming or something, you know? We're relying on you guys to make the stuff. We just provide the TV.
Though Oculus laid a pretty big foundation with having people developing stuff for VR by that time.
Well, that's the whole point of the guy's video, is that he is not seeing, like, most of the titles that have come out since the launch of Vive have just been garbage shovelware from one or two person studios. And it's like, that's great that they're trying stuff, but it's like they're also all broken and you have to buy pre-alphas. Whereas, like, meanwhile, Oculus is spending so much money making so many guarantees that it's like we can afford to make this complete thing. Anyway, it was a good video. I'll have to remember the guy's name.
Certainly interesting ways of handling that.
I mean, that's the, you know, the advantage of Facebook being a company market cap of like $380 billion that clearly is a media company, though pretends that it's not. And you look at how, you know, when Zuckerberg gives the demos of that stuff, that you see that, you know, they've been writing a lot of checks in this town, I can tell you that, for developing content. And they don't, you know, where, and it's weird because it's like, from a technology point of view, like, the Vive, as you said, the Vive feels like it just arrived more fully complete, where Oculus is like, oh yeah, now here are our controllers, you know, and here are these other things. And, you know, I was frustrated early on with my development kit for Oculus because it was like this, yeah, it'll support this and this, like, nah, we decided not, you know. And it's like,
yeah,
okay, all right, just put it over here.
But I think Valve, I think, especially looking at like this lineup of what they will talk about, with VR being its own, you know, header of like one third of all of this stuff, like, it's clear that they know that the Steam VR tech is big in a way that they need to, you know, handle. But I think I also think if you look at like with the Steam machines, where they're like, well, we'll make something, we'll make a computer and we'll set our own standards, and it just not taking off because the opening up of Steam and being on, you know, PCs and every platform as much as possible worked so much better than trying to say we're going to do our own proprietary thing, you know?
Yeah.
I don't 100% know that I made the point
a point that I wanted.
No, you didn't. No, I mean, but Steam succeeded because it was this sort of thing that if you invested in that system, you knew you could do it on a bunch of different platforms, you're gonna be fine. Where then they go, and now we're gonna have our platform. It's like, that's not why we loved you.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And especially with, like, because the Vive is like this collaboration between HTC and Valve, with all of this Steam VR technology and software under there, that you would think at some point Steam would say, okay, we've figured it out. We've got this device that someone else made, and now the code works and it's here and you know it's great. Now go make your own with these specs so that they've set the low, you know, the floor of what a competitive VR market space could look like. Especially if all of these, if there's a world where people are making Steam VR compatible headsets mm-hmm. that all work with all of these Steam games.
Right.
Then suddenly you don't have two big different platforms. You've got, you've Androidized, you know, right. VR.
Well, and that's what I'd like to see them do. But again, you know, we'll find out if they, you know, what they could do to make that happen. Yeah. It's just that, you know, I don't know, it's so early that it's a tough nut
well,
to
yeah,
crack.
Yeah, and you look at the chipset, like you saw, Sharp unveiled some really cool new display technology game with a higher density display is for VR. Qualcomm has shown some really cool chipsets and stuff, and it's like, man, 2018 is going to be really, really awesome.
Oh, sure, know? Sure. Yeah, but you know, I mean, anyway, hey, speaking of VR, I got two people here in studio who've never experienced it and need to play it.
Later.
All right.
All right. Bye, guys.
We'll say goodbye to the stream for right now, but enjoy your Sundays.